Okay, they turn into Acts chapter 13. We have, I guess, a new friend to be put on our prayer list. We still have Bo and Sharon, and we got a guy named Tex. He's in surgery now, having back surgery, and he potentially has cancer also. And there's a young man I just met at work. His wife, we just found out, she's an MD Anderson in Houston. He's working here in Pensacola and driving back to Houston on the weekends. And she has bone cancer, going through some treatments also. And he's kind of in a bad situation. He just accepted a job with us about 2 weeks ago. About a week after accepting a job with us, found out his wife has major problems with cancer and going through lots and lots of chemotherapy. So pray for him. Very expensive. He can't hardly quit and go back there because of insurance problems and such. And he has a he's in his probably 30s. He has a, they have a 10-year-old daughter also. Okay, we're going to look at a verse tonight. It's in Acts chapter 13. Normally when a person thinks about Acts chapter 13, always think about in chapter, in verse 1 and 2, where God says that he separates out Barnabas and Paul into the work where he had called them. I think about that verse, and I also think about the verse in chapter 13, verse about 38, down through those verses, where I can see in those verses for sure that there's a difference in what Paul is preaching here and what Jesus Christ had gave Peter to preach. But there's also some another real important verse that jumps out at me in Acts chapter 13, and that's what we want to go over with tonight. And before I get going, we know that in Psalms chapter 12, verse 6, it says, "The words of the Lord are pure words as silver tried in a furnace of earth, purified seven times. Thou shalt keep them, O Lord. Thou shalt preserve them from this generation forever." So I am absolutely 100% confident that God has given us and preserved his word. It's the King James Bible for lots and lots of different reasons, but it's God's truth. So that's rock solid for me. In Matthew chapter 24, about verse 38, it says, "Heaven and earth shall pass away, but my words shall never pass away." So I have them. In 1 Timothy 3:16, it says, "All scripture is given by inspiration of God. It is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works." So I have God's absolute perfect word. Now there may be places in here I don't understand it. There's a lot of things I don't understand, but I accept it as being absolute truth. So the verse that we're going to look at tonight, I may not have the explanation of it exactly correct. I think God will show it to me if I study and pray to understand his word. I think I'll get better understanding of it. But I want to take a look at it tonight, and we'll walk through it. I did go and look at some other references to see if I could find some help in what other people have thought about this verse, but I just looked under three different other references, three different other authors, and I couldn't find anything. They jumped over it. So we don't want to jump over it. I may not have the right explanation of it, and people use this to show that this is an error in the King James Bible, but I guarantee you it isn't an error. God put it in there to test us, and there's an answer to it. And so I'm going to give you my understanding of the way I see the answer at this particular time. Reiterating again, I know that this is God's perfect word. It's not an error. I may not know the explanation of it. I may not know the verses to help explain it, but they're in here. They're in here. All right, let's take a look at it. Now let's go and read Acts chapter 13. And we will start in verse. We're starting in verse 16. Now, chapter 13 is the first missionary trip that Paul went out on. And he's out going through the countryside. And he's up in the Antioch. And I call this Antioch number 2 because it's not Antioch in Syria, but it's the Antioch that's in Pisidia. So it's a different Antioch. And up here in that region, and also on this same missionary journey, is where Paul in Lystra was stoned to death. Also in this same region in Lystra, on his second missionary journey, Paul picked up Timothy, and it was Timothy. So here we have Paul on his first missionary journey. He's up in Antioch, number 2, and he's given an explanation to the folks there in the synagogue, and here's what he's saying. In verse 16 it says, then Paul, after they got through reading the scriptures and asked, anybody got anything to say about these scriptures? Wouldn't you like to go to a denominational church and they read some scriptures and then they stop and say, is anyone in the audience like to make a few comments on these scriptures? Wouldn't you like to be there? Wouldn't you like to be able to do that and show them the mystery that was given to Paul and that how we, by faith in Jesus Christ, shed blood, we can be saved, we can be sealed until the day of our redemption. We have our atonement now, it's only based on Jesus Christ's faith and our faith in Him. Wouldn't you like to be able to do that and show Him rightly dividing in the Scripture? Wouldn't that be good? So Paul took advantage of this opportunity, and here's what Paul said. Then Paul stood up and beckoned with his hand, saying, I guess he was using his hands. He beckoned with his hands, and he said, men of Israel, that's the Jewish people here in this synagogue, and ye that fear God, give audience. These people that feared God, I assumed that these folks were proselytes. These were Gentiles, feared God, and they were in there in this synagogue, and they were listening. And so, evidently, this is the first time that Paul has been there, so I don't think they knew the mystery. So I say these are probably proselytes. And I think you see that somewhere down a little bit further in the chapter here somewhere. I may not be able to find it real quick. All right, it's in that chapter, in this chapter somewhere. All right. It's all right. Go to verse 17. They got Paul talking to them, to this audience. The God of this people of Israel chose our fathers and exalted the people when they dwelt as strangers in the land of Egypt. So Paul goes all the way back and talks about the history of the Jewish people. He talks about them being in Egypt. And with a high arm, brought he them out of it. God brought, to use Moses, to bring the Jewish people out of Egypt. All right, let's go on. And about the time of 40 years, suffered he their manners in the wilderness. So you and I know that they were in the wilderness for 40 years. And when he had destroyed seven nations in the land of Canaan, we know that Joshua came in there, went across the Jordan River, and came in and destroyed, occupied seven nations. And it took a period of time, and we're going to look at that time in a minute. He divided their land to them by lot. Joshua divided the land up and gave it to the children of Israel by tribes. How many tribes stayed? I hope I get this right. How many tribes stayed on the east side of the Jordan River? I think it was 2.5 tribes. Okay, on the other side, if you got 2.5, that's 9.5 that was on the west side of the Jordan River. Verse 20. And after that, he gave unto them judges. Well, we know what came after Joshua went in, took the land, divided the land up, then who ruled? We didn't have Moses. Moses had died. Who ruled Israel? Judges. They had a judge. They had judges that they ruled. What was one judge's name? Samuel was a judge. We're going to look about Samuel in a moment. So they had judges. So how long did they have the judges? Look at verse 20. We're going to come back to this one in detail shortly. And after that, he gave unto them judges about the space of 450 years. Remember that? We're going to look at it. Until Samuel the prophet. And afterward, they desired a king. We know that after Eli died, then we had Samuel still a judge for a period of time. And when Samuel got old, his two sons were going to take over his duty, and they were derelict. They stole from the people. They were not good. And the people said, man, we don't want this. We want a king like everybody else. And what king was given to them, Alan? What was the first king?
Saul.
It was Saul. Who wanted Saul? The people wanted Saul. Is that what God wanted for them? No. God did not want a king for them. And so therefore, they chose Saul because Saul was a great orator. He was tall. He was handsome. He was good in battle. And so they wanted this great leader. They wanted Saul to be their king. And who anointed him to be their king? Samuel did. All right, verse 21. And afterward they desired a king, and God gave unto them Saul, the son of Cis, a man of the tribe of Benjamin, for the space of 40 years. 40 years. Now let's go back and I'll show you what an apparent era. If people look at this and say, hey, here, this is a typographical era. This is an era. I did go look in two other so-called versions or translations, and they also had 450 years. Okay, so I know, based on what's in the King James Bible, that 450 years in verse 20 was in the manuscripts. This is what God preserved through all the years. It's 450 years. Now let's go back and let's look at it and see the apparent difficulty here. Okay? All right, let's go to Deuteronomy. Go to Deuteronomy chapter 8. And God's Word, His verses, His preserved Word, it's what's important. There's where the proof text is, not with me. God uses unclean vessels like me to try to get out and give His Word. And so therefore, who gets the glory? God gets the glory. We're all unclean vessels. Somebody's name came up today about a situation. God can still use unclean vessels to get out His Word. And He does. All right, look at Deuteronomy chapter 8, verse 1. All the commandments which I command thee this day shall observe to do, that you may live and multiply and go in and possess the land which the Lord sware unto you. And thou shalt remember all the way which the Lord thy God led thee these 40 years in the wilderness. Why? To humble thee and to prove thee, to know what was in thy heart, whether thou wouldst keep His commandments or not. And what did they prove? How did they do to the test?
Failed.
They flunked, didn't they? God tested them. So you reckon God tests us? How does He reckon He tests us today? Lots and lots of different ways. God wanted to test their heart. What was in their heart when things get tough, when the cares of this world, the deceitfulness of riches beat upon us, what's in our heart? How do we address that? So God tested them. So they all flunked. And how long were they in the wilderness? Right, this is going to be real important, so watch it. They were in the wilderness 40 years. We got a Bible verse that supports that, don't we? Now let's go to Joshua chapter 14. Joshua 14, right after Deuteronomy, right before Judges. Joshua 14, and Joshua 14, verse 6. I can get to it. Joshua 14, verse 6, and it says, and the children of Judah came unto Joshua in Gilgal, and Caleb the son of, and I'm going to skip some of these names, but that's okay. The Lord said to Moses, the man of God concerning me and thee in Kadesh Barnea, 40 years old was I when Moses, the servant of the Lord, sent me from Kadesh Barnea to spy out the land. And I brought him word again, as it was in my heart. So we know that as soon as Moses got over in, crossed the Jordan River, very soon thereafter, he sent spies up into the land to look at the land, the promised land that God gave them. And God told them, go up there. I'll take it for you. But they sent spies to spy it out. And that's not what God asked them to do. He said, just go up there and I'll handle it for you. But they didn't do it that way. So we know that when they came back, they were afraid. They said, there's giants up there. There's all kinds of difficulties. We can't do it. And they couldn't do it on their own power. But God could have done it in His power if they were to obey Him. Go down to verse 10. So we know that Joshua was 40 years old. Now verse 10. And now, behold, the Lord hath kept me alive, as He said, these 45 years. So Joshua was kept alive 45 years to this point. And what has happened during this time? What has happened during this time that they were in the wilderness? How many years, Linda? 40 years is in the wilderness. And what happened next after being in the wilderness? They crossed over to Jordan and they took over some of the nations. They took over seven nations, as we learn in Acts chapter 13. They took over seven nations, and then Joshua divided up the land by lots and gave it to the 12 tribes of Israel. So if it was 45 years to get that accomplished, and they were in the wilderness 40 years, how many years did it take to conquer the seven nations? 40 minus 45, and we get 5 years. Okay, so I can account for 5 years here, okay? All right, after that, after they went in and established the land and took the land, then we have a period of time that's called the judges. They had lots of different judges that came in and judged Israel. And we're going to come back to this judging in a minute. Now then we came down after the judges, we came to Saul. Saul was their first king, and they chose Saul. How long did Saul reign? Go to 2 Chronicles chapter 9, verse 30. We already know the answer. Just look at it and establish it. 2 Chronicles 9, 30. You get ready, because you already jumped ahead, you know what I'm getting ready to do, but you're getting ready to see something in just a moment. 2 Chronicles 9, 30 says, and it says, and Solomon reigned in Jerusalem over all Israel 40 years. So, okay, I got 40 years now for Samuel. All right, how about Daniel? He was the next king, wasn't he? All right, go to 1 Chronicles. Go back to 1 Chronicles 29, 27. 1 Chronicles 29. And it says, let's go to 26. Thus David, the son of Jesse, reigned over all Israel. And the time that he reigned over Israel was 40 years. Seven of that was in Hebron, and the 33 years was in Jerusalem. He reigned 40 years. All right, now then, here's a big verse. Go to 1 Kings chapter 6, verse 2. 1 Kings chapter 6. When God says, line upon line, precept upon precept, here a little, there a little, that's what we're doing. We have to take everything in here to be able to get the correct answers. We have to take all of it, God's Word, all His preserved Word, to try to get things figured out. You can't do it in one or two verses. You can't even find the mystery given to Paul in two or three verses. He's got it scattered out throughout his epistles, but we know what it was, and we know where to get it. All right, First Kings chapter 6, verse 2. Let's go to verse 1. First Kings chapter 6, verse 1, it says, And it came to pass in the 480th year, after the children of Israel were come out of the land of Egypt, in the fourth year of Solomon's reign over Israel, in the month Zeph, which is the second month, that he began to build the house of the Lord. Okay, so therefore I know from this verse how long it was from when they came out of Egypt to the fourth year of Solomon, where they began to build the kingdom, the temple. How many years is that? It's 480. Now write that down. Write that down. Consider it 480. So therefore, if I come over here and I add all these up, just like we got in Acts chapter 13. In Acts chapter 13, it says they were in the wilderness. There was a period of time where they took to destroy seven nations. We had the judges. We've got Saul. We've got David. And we've got Solomon. We add all that up, and it's got to come to 480 years, correct? Right. I didn't put in this column here how long this period of time of the judges is. I put X. So if you add all these other numbers and subtract it from 480, that'll let you know what X is. Guess what X is? X is equal to 351. 351. Now let's go back to Acts chapter 13, and here is the apparent problem. Just simple math, 351 is the time of the judges for this county from when they left. When Joshua destroyed the seven nations unto their first king, Saul. And they had judges all the way up to Saul. Okay? And we know that period of time is 351 years. Now, look at this carefully. I'm sure you already know it. We go back to Acts 13. And here's the discrepancy. And here's what you might do when you first read it. And this is what Satan wants people to do, to have them not have confidence in the King James Bible. We know that practically every so-called Christian school, practically every church, especially every denominational church, does not use the King James Bible as the preserved Word of God. They may say they prefer it. They may say it's the best translation. They may say a lot of things. And a lot of them, and they don't even do that. They'll read other verses, other so-called translations and all, and they don't even get to it. So here's a verse that somebody was reading through down through here, and they had the right kind of heart. They understood that this is God's preserved word, that they may have a question. Go to verse 20. And when he had destroyed seven nations in the land of Canaan, he divided the land to them by lot. That's right here. That's right here. From here to here, it says, and after that, he gave unto them judges about the space of 450 years until Samuel the prophet. It says 450 years. So it says this number is 450 years. See that, Linda?
This is about the space of
450 years. Okay, that's correct. We're going to talk about that in detail in a minute. But 351 ain't about 450. It's off. Look how much it's off. It appears to be off almost 100. So someone might would say, oh, I know what the problem is. The verse in Acts 13, verse 20, is a typographical error. Some scribe, instead of writing 350, wrote 450. And it was kept throughout time. But we know God said he preserved his word. I have it. And it says 450. So 351 is not about 450. But we're going to use that word about in a few minutes to try to explain this. So where's the difficulty? How can I explain this? How can I do this? Now, I wish I had some more verses to help me with this, but I'll show you the verses that I currently have, And maybe God will show me some other verses in the future. Whether he does or whether he doesn't, I know that it's 450 years. It is written in Acts chapter 13. I know I got to understand that. I know it's 480 years from here to here. I can do the math. This is 351 years. So why the difference between these two numbers? All right, here is my explanation of that. Okay? All right, it appears, and it appears as if when during this period of time, during the judges, while Israel is in the promised land, and Saul is their king, don't have a king yet, while they were in the promised land, when they were obeying God, God counted that time and on one clock. When they were in servitude to the heathens, God counted that in a different clock, a different time. All right, let's look at it and see how it comes out and how close it is. Okay? So, in one place over here, God counts the complete time as the calendar, whether or not they're in servitude or not servitude. Over here, he didn't count it. All right, let's go back and look at it. All right, let's look at it. Go to Judges. Go to Judges chapter 3, verse 8. Judges chapter 3. Verse 8. And it says, therefore, this is Israel, and Israel had sinned against God. They had done wrong. Their outservant served. Let's go to verse 7. They're serving Balaam. All right, look at verse 7. And the children of Israel did evil in the sight of the Lord, and forgot the Lord their God, and served Balaam in the groves. Therefore, the anger of the Lord was hot against Israel, and he sold them into the hand of Cushan-Rishathaim, king of Macedonia. And the children of Israel served this fellow 8 years. They were in servitude 8 years. Now, I'm not going to write this on the board, but you can. 8 years. Now, go to verse 14 of the same chapter.
What chapter?
Judges chapter 3, verse 14. And we see another servitude. So when they were in servitude these 8 years, after this 8 years of servitude, they become humble to God, and they pray to God, says, God, forgive us, we won't do wrong, please help us, and God helped them. They came back, wasn't too much longer, they're back in the same mess that they were in before. Okay, and then God puts them back in servitude or punishment. Verse 14 says, so the children of Israel served Eglon, the king of Moab, 18 years. Here's 18 more years of servitude. Go to chapter 4, verse 3. Chapter 4, verse 3. We see this again. It doesn't call it servitude here, but they were oppressed. They had done wrong. They had sinned against God. And God had sent the government of other countries to come in and oppress them, have servitude over them, have them delivered unto them, to punish them, to get them to turn back to him. So in one calendar, one column, one calendar, God excludes these years in the counting. In the other column, he counts it. Verse 3, and the children of Israel cried unto the Lord, for he had 900 chariots of iron. In 20 years, he mightily oppressed the children of Israel. Why? Because they had done evil. You go back up in verse 1 of that same chapter. The children of Israel, again, did evil in the sight of the Lord. And he brought this servitude, he brought this oppression down on them because they were not doing as he wanted them to do. They weren't obeying him. So we see that throughout the book of Judges. Go to chapter 6, verse 1. Chapter 6, verse 1, we see the same thing. And the children of Israel did evil in the sight of the Lord, And the Lord delivered them into the hand of Midian 7 years. So after 7 years, he delivered them. He delivered them because of their heart, because they humbled themselves and said, man, we've sinned, we've done wrong, we know we've done wrong, help us out, and God helped them. And we see this over and over and over. We see this throughout eternity, all the time on the earth. We see it with us, we see it with people. We see it, we see it, we see it, we see it. All right, go to chapter 10, verse 8. 10, verse 8. We see another period of time. Chapter 10, verse 8. In that year they vexed and oppressed the children of Israel 18 years. All the children of Israel that were on the other side of Jordan in the land of the Amorites, which is in Gilead. So here is 18 years. Go to chapter 13, verse 1. And the children of Israel did evil again in the sight of the Lord, and the Lord delivered them into the hand of the Philistines 40 years. So they were in servitude, oppressed, and delivered all these different years. And God had that as a reason to bring them back to him. If you add all those numbers up, if you add them up, it comes to 111 years. So if you were to subtract 111 years from 450, you get 339. With 339, let's go back to Acts chapter 13. Go back to Acts 13. In Acts chapter 13, just go to verse 20. And after that he gave unto them judges about the space of 450 years. So if I were to say about, and this is, if I subtract this servitude off during the judges period, then I come up with 339 that I have to compare with 451. That's a difference of 12 years. So can I say that this number is about that number? Probably. That's they're off only about 4%. 4% error is about. So that word about will probably work here. So that could be one answer. One answer is subtract out the servitude. I get 339. Compared to 351, which is 12 years difference, which is about 4% error. So is a 4% error about? If I were to tell you something costs 96 cents versus 100 cents, would you say 96 is about 100? I say, yeah, that's probably reasonable. God put the word about in there for a reason. He put it in there for an absolute reason. There's no mistake. It's a reason. We know that there's lots of one little words put in Scripture that's extremely important. And so does Satan. And so does Satan tries his best to take them out. About. So that I think that'll work. All right, there's another way of looking at it. There's another way of looking at it. All right? Which is right? Or maybe there's a better answer? There could be. All I know is that the 450 years as God had them put in here is God's preserved word. So it's right. Here's an explanation. He didn't count the time over here when they were in servitude. They were not doing as he wanted them to do. So he discounted that. Now here's another thought. All right. Look in Acts 13, verse 20 real carefully. And when we look at there's lots of ways I guess you can look at Scripture. One is you can just read it. I've heard people say, do two things with Scripture. Read it. Just keep right, just read it. Don't pause around a lot. Just get the main story. Just read it. And then another way to look at it is study. Study means to slow down, look at each word, look at the commas, try to understand what we're reading, not just reading words. So there's two ways of doing that, and both of them has some attributes to them. All right, verse 20. And after that, that's after he divided the land up, and after that he gave unto them judges about the space of 450 years until Samuel the prophet. Until Samuel the prophet. Well, Samuel is not only a prophet, it says up to Samuel being a prophet. There's time after Samuel. He was a prophet for a certain period of time, and he also was a judge all the way to the end of his life. So there's some time here after Samuel the prophet until Saul the king. How much time is there? Would it be the 12 years or not? If it turned out to be absolutely perfectly 12 years and I could find it, I'd say, well, that's it. That's it right there. I haven't been able to find that. But let's look at that time period after Samuel the prophet. Okay? What time is there there?
Until Samuel the prophet.
I know that. So until, there's 450 years, Linda, until the prophet. So there's time, when he's a prophet, there's time after he's a prophet, and there's time that he's a judge after he's a prophet. Okay? I'm looking for 12 additional years that I could add to this 339, then the math would work out perfect, and I wouldn't need the word about. But about will work. I'm trying to say, can I get the about closer? And I probably cannot. But let's look at what God has. Let's search this down. Go to 1 Samuel chapter 3. Go to 1 Samuel chapter 3. Verse 18. Alright, we know the story of Samuel and his mother and dad. His mother wanted a son, and his mother's name was Hannah, and she didn't have a son. And the priest, I think Eli, saw her praying and asked her what was she praying about. And Eli told her, go home, you don't have a son, and you dedicate him to the Lord. And she did. And it was Samuel. She brought it back to Eli, and he worked there in the temple and served Israel. And God called him three times, and he didn't know who was God calling him. He didn't know God at that time in his life. And how old he was, I don't know. Probably around 12 years old, most likely. Why? Because his mother had some children after that. If you say that they were, it takes 2 years for a woman normally to have a new child, then you can come up with an age at the birth, about 12. I don't know how old he was. But the fourth time God called him, Samuel understood who was calling him. It wasn't Eli, it was God. And Samuel turned his life over to God. All right, let's go to, Samuel chapter 3, verse 18. And Samuel told him every whit and hid nothing from him. And this is what was going to happen to Eli, because Eli allowed his two sons to do evil in the temple and did not do right. God was going to have them killed, and Eli was going to die because of it, because he did not keep his children under subjection. Verse 18, and Samuel told him every whit and hid nothing from him. Samuel, Eli wanted to know what God had revealed to Samuel about his future, about the situation. And Eli said, tell me what it is. All right, the rest of that verse. And he said, it is the Lord, let him do what seemeth good. So Samuel here is prophesying. He's giving what God told him. He's telling Eli. He's prophesying to Eli what's going to happen. Go down to chapter 4, verse 1. And the word of Samuel came to all Israel. So all Israel listen for Samuel. Samuel was teaching them. He was prophesying unto them. He was saying God's word. In the word of Samuel came to all Israel. Now Israel went out against the Philistines to battle, and Samuel would end up telling them what would happen. Look at verse 20 of chapter 3. So this verse says, "And all Israel, from Dan even to Beersheba, knew that Samuel was established to be a prophet of the Lord." So he's a prophet. And he's a prophet here. He prophesied to Samuel. He prophesied to him things would happen during the battle with the Philistines. Okay? So the verse in Acts 13, verse 20, says that it's 450 years from the judges unto Samuel the prophet. So I would say the prophet would be here in 1 Samuel chapter 3, verse 20. He's the prophet there. So from that, so there's time after that. So how much time is after that that's not, that's within this number here? Because this timing goes from the destruction all the way to Samuel. Alright? Let's take a look at that. Alright, go to, so we know what happens in chapter 4 of 1 Samuel. In chapter 5, we see that the ark, that they came in and fought the Philistines, and the Philistines took the Ark of the Covenant. Let's go to chapter 6, verse 1. They took the Ark of the Covenant in battle, and when they took it, all right, let's read verse 6. Chapter 6, verse 1. And the Ark of the Lord was in the country of the Philistines 7 months. So they took the Ark from the Jewish people, took it with them, and took it away from them. And when they did, then Eli's two sons were killed during the battle. They came back and told Eli, "Hey, your two sons have been killed. And not only that, the Philistines have taken the Ark of the Lord." And what happened to our buddy Eli? Our chubby little Eli.
Fell off and then broke his neck.
Yeah, he fell over backwards and he broke his neck and he died. So that ended him. So the Ark was taken 7 months. All right, I'm looking for time in here. All right, let's go to chapter 7, verse 2. And it came to pass while the ark abode in Kirjath-Jearim that the time was long. In other words, they moved it and went up to this town, and it was there a long time, for it was 20 years, and all the house of Israel lamented after the Lord. So they took the ark. So it's at least 20 years and 7 months that the ark was gone out from Israel. But they went and got it. All right. And so it came back. All right, so look in chapter 7, verse 15. And it says, "And Samuel judged Israel all the days of his life." So he was a judge. He was a judge throughout all this period of time, all the years of his life. Look in chapter 8, verse 1. "And it came to pass when Samuel was old that he made his sons judge over Israel, and they were..." Well, let's go read verse 2. "Now the name of his first born was Joel, and the name of his second, Abiath. They were judges in Beersheba. And his sons walked not in his ways, but turned aside after lucre, and took bribes and perverted judgments." What's lucre, Alan?
Money.
Money. "And the Israel, the elders of Israel gathered themselves together. They did not like this. And they said, hey, we're tired of this. We don't want the judges. We want a king." So they went out and got a king. Okay. Chapter 8, verse 5 says, "Make us a king." All right, so here's the point. If this logic we use here is not sufficient, and I try to find time here, if I try to find 12 years to make this number match up perfectly with this number, then pray tell, how am I going to do that? If I were to try that, and if it's there, and if I can prove it, and I may can, I just couldn't find the verses, then when the ark is taken away from Israel, I can't count that time. I can't count the 7 months, and I can't count the 20 years. So during that period of time, I can't count, just like I couldn't count the servitude. If that's the case, and when the ark came back to Israel, then there's a period of time when the ark came back, and when Samuel died, or when Samuel gave up his judgeship and gave it to Saul, if that period of time there is 12 years, then the numbers match up perfectly. Then that would match up perfectly. Where it says 480 years here, then I can rationalize this period of time, the 450 years versus the 351, if I don't count the servitude, if I don't count where the ark is gone, and there's 12 years left from when the ark comes back, is Samuel still the judge until Saul is made king? Now, this is A and B options, and I'm sure there's a C, and it may be one better. So option A was the 339 versus the 351 is 12 years different, 4% different between them. That's pretty close. That's about the same number. That'll probably work. If that doesn't work, then I have to subtract out the period of time that the ark was gone. And then I have to assume, because I don't have Bible verses to support it, that there's 12 years between when the ark came back and when Saul became king. Okay? All right, let's go back to Acts chapter 13. Go back to Acts chapter 13. God's preserved word is here. He puts out things. If we want to get tricked up, we can. If our heart is right and we pray to God and study God's word, there's answers in here. I had someone one time come to me with these questions that, hey, and there was a church here, a large denominational church, that was teaching a class of people certain conceived errors in the King James Bible. Well, he would come to me with one of those questions. Well, I didn't have to answer immediately. I'd go in and study it all and come up with what I thought was a reasonable explanation, give it to him. The next week, he'd come back with another one. After about the fourth week of that, I said, are you coming up with these questions or not? And he admitted that he wasn't coming up with them. He was getting them somewhere else. I said, well, we've come up with some real good answers to them. I don't see the value for us continuing this conversation. You know, I don't seem like that we're getting anywhere. I'm convinced that the King James Bible is the Word of God. When a person quits realizing that, or don't ever realize it, then I don't think that they will get the understanding of Scripture that God wants us to have. God says He does that we are carnal if we only look for milk of His Word. He wants us to have meat. And when we sit down for a meal, we don't just eat meat. We have to eat all things. So we definitely, all Scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for lots of things. We need all of it, not just meat. We would not be very healthy. So let's look at Acts 13 one more time. Verse 17. The God of this people of Israel chose our fathers and exalted the people when they dwelt as strangers in the land of Egypt, and with a high arm brought He them out of it. And about the time of 40 years suffered He their manners in the wilderness. And when He had destroyed 7 nations in the land of Cana, He divided their land to them by lot. And after that, He gave unto them judges about the space of 450 years until Samuel the prophet. So now then, we can understand this. I have an explanation for this, so I know that there's no error. There's no error in God's preserved word. God told you and I, if we desire it, He doesn't force us, that we can accept Jesus Christ as our Savior. He's the one that's going to has paid for our sins, we can accept the shedding of his blood for the remission of our sins, and by faith in that, not our works, not our lifestyle, God says, I'll save you eternally and seal you with my Holy Spirit. And that's a precious thing. To see a man that's going into surgery that may not come out of it or may have a short life period and knows that he has a hope that's based on Scripture, knows that he's saved, ready to go meet his Lord and my Lord, then that gives great comfort. Otherwise, there's no peace, there's no comfort. We came into this world with nothing, and we're not going to take anything out but our faith in Jesus Christ. That's what's important. And God gave us his perfect word, and he is to be exalted, not me, not mankind, or anybody. It's perfect. So, thank you very much.
God is beautiful, and